सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचा मलं शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तं प्रवरं मुनीनां पतञ्जलिं प्राञ्जलिरानतोऽस्मि। नमस्कार टू ऑल एंड वेलकम टू द next session of the Bharatiya Darshana Shastravali series. Today, the term yoga has become a very popular term across the globe. And it's also probably one of the most misunderstood terms that we have in our Sanatana Dharma. It is hence that we have the session today on Yoga Darshana, what it is and what it is not. And to take us through this session, we have a wonderful speaker with us, Dr. Veena Londe, ma'am. Veena, ma'am, welcome to the Bharatiya Darshana Shastravali series.
Namaskar.
Namaskar. Veena, ma'am, was a former professor of Sanskrit in Nalanda Nritya Kala Mahavidyalaya and the visiting faculty at the University of Mumbai. She is a trained yoga teacher, actively engaged in propagating the alternative theory of space, time, and motion. She conducts workshops, lectures, and treats patients through this therapy. She has done a course in neuroscience of yoga with eminent doctors in Pune. And she's also authored a book, Interpreting Patanjali's Yoga Darshana, Theory and Practice. We couldn't find a better person to speak on Yoga Darshana, both the theoretical and the practical aspects of it, and also explain to our listeners of what is Yoga Darshana and what is not. So Veena ma'am, once again, welcome to this series, and we are really eagerly awaiting to listen from you. Before we start the session, I would request all the participants, if you have any questions, please mention them in the chat box, address it to the moderator, and I shall take it up towards the end of the session with the speaker. And also request all of you to please mute your videos during the session. Veena ma'am, over to you.
Thank you. Namaskar. I bow down to Sage Patanjali. I sincerely thank Chinmaya Vishwavidyapeeth for inviting me to this discourse on Yoga Darshana. I welcome you all. The topic given to me is Yoga Darshana, what it is and what it is not. During my lecture, I'm going to discuss what Yoga Darshana is. This will automatically tell you what it is not. Yet, wherever necessary, I will emphasize those points. Let us trace the history of yoga from Vedic tradition. Yoga in Vedic tradition. The word yoga is used in Rigveda in the sense of yoking horses, achieving the unachieved and the like. The yoga ideas can be traced to Katha, Shvetashvatara and Maitrayani Upanishad. It's okay if we do not have the slide. Kiranji, it's okay if we do not have the slide. Yes. So, science of breath had attracted attention of many early Upanishads, but had not developed into any systematic form. Certain practices known as yoga were prevalent in Upanishads, and they were taken over or accepted by Jainism and Buddhism also. These yoga practices were accepted as traditional customs. They were supposed to give spiritual, intellectual, and physical powers to the practitioners. Now let us see how Panini derives this word yoga. He derives it in two ways. He says, yuga samadhau. That means he gives the meaning of yoga as samadhi, concentration. And this is a very technical meaning of the word yoga. He also gives the meaning of yujur yoga, the popular meaning that we know of yoga as to join, to combine, etc. Different types of rigor and asceticism were called brahmacharya in Panini's time. Associated with these, a definite system of mental discipline developed, which was called yoga. Now we come to Patanjali, 2nd century BC. Who was this Patanjali? He must have been the notable person who collected different forms of yoga practices prevalent in his time. He must have gleaned the diverse ideas associated with yoga and grafted them on Sankhya metaphysics and wrote his Yoga Darshana. Therefore, yoga got a place in the 6 orthodox philosophical systems of India, Astika Darshanas of India. The very first sutra, Atha Yoga Anushasanam, the word Anushasana in this particular sutra suggests that Patanjali is only the expounder of yoga and not the founder of it. The Anu in Anushasana suggests this meaning. Next. Yoga Darshana is written in a sutra form. It has 195 sutras, aphorisms, divided into 4 chapters. They are Samadhi, Sadhana, Vibhuti, and Kaivalyapada. The deeper meaning of the sutras is explained by Vyasa in his Bhashya. If we do not read Vyasa Bhashya, we will not understand the real meaning of Yoga Darshana. Then commentaries on commentary, Vachaspati Mishra's Tattva Vaisharadi Tika, Bhoja's Rajamartanda Vritti, Vijnana Bhikshu's Yoga Vartika is there, Nagoji Bhatta's Chhaya Vyakhya. These are the books available which are written in Sanskrit, but in English and in regional languages also. There are numerous books, to name a few. Raja Yoga by Swami Vivekananda, then by Taimini's Science of Yoga, Bharatiya Manas Shastra, Athava Patanjali's Yoga Darshan. This is by K.K. Kolhatkar. And very, very firmly he says for the first time that Yoga Darshana is Indian psychology. Then we have Ananda Rushi's Patanjali Yoga Darshana Ek Abhyas, Karan Velkar's, so many and so forth, Hariharananda Aranya's Yoga Philosophy. All these books are very good. Next. Now let us see the meaning of yoga in the Yoga Sutra. The word yoga is explained as samadhi by Vyasa. And yoga samadhi, such as Sarvabhaumaha Chittasya Dharmaha. That is what is said by Vyasa in the very first sutra, in its commentary on the very first sutra of Yoga Shastra. It means balanced state of chitta. The meaning of samadhi here is the balanced state of chitta. And this meaning of yoga as samadhi is valid in the entire yoga darshan. It please may be noted that yoga does not have the sense of joining in the entire yoga darshan. It is consistent with the Sankhya metaphysics, in which matter and spirit are differentiated by developing viveka khyati. Viveka khyati means discrimination between Purusha and Prakriti. Next. Now let us go to the definition of yoga. Yogas chitta vritti nirodha. Patanjali defines yoga as the restraint of the modifications of chitta. Chitta makes us aware of the internal and external world by modifying itself constantly. There are 5 types of modifications: pramana, right knowledge; viparyaya, wrong knowledge; vikalpa, fancy; nidra, sleep; and smriti, that is memory. These are the processes through which we know, we cognize anything. These modifications are also colored by the kleshas. Vrittayaha panchatayaha klishta klishtaha. And the kleshas are contrary knowledge, avidya; ego, asmita; attraction is raga; repulsion is dvesha; and fear is abhinivesha. All these are clubbed together under the name klesha in yogic terminology. Thus, we can understand that there is constant turbulence at the level of chitta, and it cannot be silenced on its own. It has to be quietened, and this is done by yoga. Next. What is the aim of yoga? In the 3rd sutra, Patanjali says, Tada drashtu swarupe avasthanam. Tada means, when the modifications of chitta are restrained, then the seer, the Purusha, is established in his own fundamental nature, in his swarupa. Yoga Sutra takes us through different stages of its practical discipline, which would give control over these modifications, as also would reduce the hold of kleshas, so that the spirit, the seer, is established in his own form. Next. As we have seen in Nyaya philosophy also and Sankhya philosophy, Dukkha Nivrutti is the goal. So also, Yoga Darshana says, Heyam Dukkham Anagatam. Pain not yet come is to be avoided, because the pain that we have experienced in the past is gone. The pain that we are experiencing is in the present. But what can be avoided is the pain in future. Then Patanjali goes deeper into the problem and says, what is the cause of this pain? And the cause is conjunction, that is sanyoga of Prakriti and Purusha. Drashtru drushyayoho sanyogaha heya hetuhu. And what is the cause of this sanyoga? Is avidya. Tasya hetuhu avidya. So what can be done? This avidya should disappear. With the disappearance of avidya, conjunction also will disappear. Tadabhavat sanyoga bhavo. Hanam, that is the disappearance. And then there is absence of influence of Prakriti over Purusha. Tadrushehe kaivalyam. This is the kaivalya of drashta. Thus, yoga darshana provides a framework of mind-body practices as the tool of attainment of philosophical objectives of Sankhya. So, it is the practical manual to experience whatever is given in the Sankhya philosophy. Before discussing different paths to samadhi, to goal, I want to discuss about chitta vikshepas, the distractions of chitta, and which are called antaraya. These are obstacles. They are faced by people in daily life, whatever profession they are pursuing or whatever stage of life they are in. So it is sarvajanina and sarvakalika, not only limiting itself to yogic practitioners. There might be a variety of reasons, okay, ranging from some are physical, like disease or laziness. There might be a variety of reasons ranging from mental lethargy, sthyana, doubt, carelessness, seeing illusions, which will definitely make the mind restless. The unceasing craving for sensual objects, as also the eagerness to ascend higher and higher, and the inability to hold that position, can really increase distractions. Patanjali gives 9, which I have translated in English. Now, these obstacles, what do they make? They make the chitta restless and scattered. These give rise to sorrow, dukkha. And when we know that we cannot remove this pain, it turns into despair, daurmanasya. This doesn't remain on psychological level. It trickles down on the physical level, giving rise to angame jayatva and shvasa prashvasa, which means tremors in the body or losing the tonic rhythm of the body and losing the rhythm of breathing also, breathing becoming very hard. Patanjali does not stop here. He gives many various means to overcome these obstacles, and these are clubbed under chitta prasadana. Recitation of omkara can make the mind very calm. Focusing on some internal points, practicing breath control, cultivating positive attitudes like maitri, karuna, mudita, upeksha, focusing or fixing mind on some saints who are viragis, who are really detached. Some of these can really have made the mind very calm and quiet. Patanjali's greatness is that he says, if you don't approve any of these, yatha abhimata dhanatva, you meditate on anything that pleases you. And he throws the responsibility of choosing a proper thing on the practitioner, himself. Though Patanjali is known for Ashtanga Yoga, he really gives 4 paths to reach Samadhi. They are meant for different types of practitioners. Now, those who are Uttamadhikarins, for them, only Abhyasa and Vairagya are enough in order to restrain the modifications of Chitta.
Peena ma'am.
Yes.
There's a request if you can go slightly slower on the different terms.
Okay.
You're explaining the terms. Yeah. Okay.
Abhyasa and Vairagya. Abhyasa means practice and Vairagya means detachment. So only these 2 can be followed, or these can be used by superior type of people. Uttama Prakriti, Uttamadhikarins, who can have Nirodha, that is constrained or restrained on the chitta vrittis, modifications of chitta, and this will lead them to samadhi. But everybody is not Uttamadhikari. There are some Madhyamadhikarins, middling type of practitioners. They should do Kriya Yoga. This comprises of Tapas, Svadhyaya and Ishvara Pranidhana. I will explain these terms later. Kriya Yoga is done in order to reduce the kleshas. Then Ashtanga Yoga is for Mandalikaris, ordinary people like all of us. So when you practice all the limbs of Ashtanga, Ashtanga Yoga, then impurities from within, they are dissolved, they disappear, and there takes place inner illumination, Jnana Deepti, that will take us towards the Viveka Khyati, that is discrimination between Purusha and Prakriti, which will lead us towards Samadhi. He, Patanjali, also accepts the devotional path, Ishvara Pranidhana. So he says, Samadhi Siddhi, Ishvara Pranidhanat, means, and for that he gives Pranava Japa, Omkara Japa, because Tasya Vachakaha Pranavaha. He gives the symbolic, the linguistic symbol of Ishvara, and that is Omkara. And he says that it's japa, and not only mechanical japa, but just pondering over the meaning of Omkara will really lead you toward Samadhi. Samadhi Siddhi Ishvara Pranidhanat. I have talked about kleshas. Kriya Yoga reduces kleshas, I have told you. So in that, there are five kleshas: avidya, asmita, raga, dvesha, abhinivesha. Normally we feel avidya is ignorance, but Patanjali says avidya is contrary knowledge. That which is impermanent, we take it to be permanent. That which is impure, we take it to be pure. That which is dukkha, we take it to be sukha. And that which is non-self, we take it to be the self. Avidya is the main klesha, is the source of the latter four kleshas. If there is one disease with which we are born, it is avidya. Then we come to the next klesha, and that is asmita. Druk darshana shaktyoho ekatmate vasmita. It means identifying, as it were, the Purusha and Prakriti. What does that mean? That body, mind and intellect, taking this to be the self. This is asmita. Identifying ourselves with the animate and inanimate objects around us. That is also asmita. So my house, my furniture, my clothes, my ornaments, or my children, my friends, all this is asmita. So it is just identifying ourselves with all animate and inanimate objects. Then we come to raga. Sukhanshayi ragaha. That means, the raga means attraction. That which gives us pleasure, we are attracted towards it. Dukhanshayi dvesha. That which gives us pain, we do not like it. We are repulsive of it. If we go to see, raga and dvesha really rule all our cognition. All preferences and prejudices are due to this raga and dvesha. They are as if our paripantino, as Gita says, they are our enemies. They come and go. We have to bear with them. Gita also says that. After raga and dvesha, the last one is abhinivesha. Abhinivesha means fear of death. That means so clinging to life. Fear of death, so clinging to life. But it doesn't mean only fear of death. All sorts of fear, stress, tension, insecurity, all the feelings that are associated with these are clubbed under abhinivesha. All these five kleshas, they find place, they can be located in the limbic region of our brain. The hypothalamus, hippocampus, and amygdala, these are the places where we can locate all these kleshas. And what do they do? They always prompt us to think in improper way. And then we act also in improper way. So all our cognition is colored by this. And therefore, yoga says that not only you have to control your chitta vrittis, but you have to reduce the hold of these kleshas from your chitta vrittis. So klesha is a very important concept in yoga philosophy. Not only by Kriya Yoga, but also by Ashtanga Yoga, these kleshas can be removed. Now we will come to Ashtanga Yoga. As I have told you already, this is for Mandadhikarins. That is, all ordinary people like us who need orientation at all possible levels. Yes, I don't want the slides. Okay. Now Patanjali uses the word anga. Anga means a limb. So eight limbs together form the body of yoga. These are not sequential. Each limb is joined to the other, balancing and strengthening them as an integral part of a greater whole. At each stage of this Ashtangas, the crux seems to be voluntary control preceded by observation. The first two angas are Yama and Niyama. In that, our behavior is observed and then it is changed. In asana, our physical body is observed and then we take a certain posture. Breathing is first observed in pranayama and then we manipulate it. Orientation of senses, all the time senses are extrovert. They are observed and then they are made introvert. And thought activity is first observed and then manipulated or focused in dharana, dhyan and samadhi. Now here I want to stress one point that all those who are doing yoga all over the world, maybe most of them, 95% of them, they feel that yoga starts with asana and ends with pranayama. They don't know that it is preceded by yama and niyama and followed by still many more limbs. If we are not doing all of these limbs or trying to follow all these limbs, we are not really doing yoga. So importance of yama and niyama in Ashtanga Yoga is least understood, let aside its practice. This is a framework for practice of different limbs of yoga. These can be interpreted as values which you have to inculcate in your life. You have to practice those, not repeat them, not understand them verbally or intellectually. You have to actually practice them. Yamas are innate behavioral tendencies to be controlled, while niyamas are conducive to the process of learning. There are five yamas. Ahimsa is the first one. Ahimsa means not to hurt or to disturb stability and peace of anybody, including ourselves. Normally we feel that we don't have to hurt physically, mentally, verbally others, but we do harm ourselves. That also we have to be cautious and not do that. The positive aspect of Ahimsa is love for all and service rendered to them. Satya means truthfulness. We have heard about all these things. You'll feel what is new. But in yoga, we have to inculcate them in us. We have to follow them. So Satya is truthfulness. It's derived from the root asar, to be, exist. And it means worthy of existence. It is, see, we have many shades of untruthfulness in our speech and behavior. The hypocritical statements, the exaggeration of something, the minimization of some other thing, all these are shades of untruthfulness which we have to avoid. Third one is asteya, negation of grabbing and holding, stealing and grabbing. This is a human instinct. We have to avoid it. Normally, we do not steal concrete things. We are very civilized human beings. The concrete things we will not steal, money or any other things. But we do not mind stealing the abstract things like credit. We do not mind misappropriating public property. We do not mind misuse of privileges. All this comes under steya. All this is stealing. And we have to practice not to do this. The next one is brahmacharya. Misunderstood. The meaning is given celibacy, but it's a secondary meaning. Brahmacharya means charya, behavior, which will lead you towards Brahma, ultimate reality. It means a lifestyle of regulated consumption, essential for existence. It also implies avoiding overindulgence in anything. And the last one is aparigraha, that is, it is negation of accumulation and hoarding. Because then we have a lot of attachment to all our hoardings and accumulations, and the way we spend our time in that, in maintaining, and then we are very sorry when something is destroyed and all those things. So all these are to be negated. So these yamas provide a universal framework which make us humane. You will understand. If we do not follow yamas, we need not be called human beings. So if we follow them, then we will be humane, conservation oriented, existence promoting, consuming bare essential and abstaining from stealing and hoarding. These are the basic tenets of social wellness and even more profound ecological wellness. After yamas, we go to niyamas. There are five niyamas. The first one is shaucha. It is physical and mental purity. We are very keen on physical purity nowadays, all the more. But who looks to mental purity? Patanjali has given variety of techniques, which I have told you some of them on Chitta Prasadana. So it can really make our mind pure. Santosha refers to feeling of contentment. It is inner positive state of fullness, irrespective of expectation or outcome. Tapas. Tapas means effortful expansion of abilities, especially tolerance of internal drives and external forces. I will explain it with some example. When we fast, we are postponing our hunger and thirst. So aren't we having control over our internal drives? And when we do padayatra to some holy place, maybe Wari or some other holy place, at that time, we are bearing all the external forces, and still we are continuing with it. This is the meaning of tapas. Svadhyaya is self-study. It is an important step in assimilation of knowledge. And reading the books, you know, which are very conducive for the path that you are pursuing. The last one is Ishvara Pranidhana. It means surrendering to higher order. Thus, the five niyamas provide a universal framework of emotional wellness. Satisfied, hopeful, tolerant of hardship and uncertainty, having ability to trust and submit. They also lay the ground rules for effective learning, namely ordering, regular self-study, hard work, and deriving satisfaction, which together shape individual's character. Many sutras and many things in Patanjali are independent of system, means they do not apply only to yoga. You may be following any path. These will help you a lot. So again, I am coming back to Yama Niyama because its importance is not understood. Both these are supposed to be operative during the practice of all subsequent angas. And these are important parameters to assess one's progress on the path of yoga. It is not how well you are doing some asanas and how well you are able to retain the breath inside or outside. It is how do you behave in society? How do you behave in personal life? Have you accepted yoga as the way of life? It all depends on Yama and Niyama. For 23 hours in a day, we can follow these. But asanas and pranayama, we can do only maybe 1 hour, 1.5 hour, that's all. Important thing is that higher order brain systems are involved in the practice of these Yama and Niyama. Next slide. Now we come to the asana, which everybody knows, and I think everybody will be comfortable with it now. Because for asana, Patanjali gives only 3 sutras. He does not mention any of the asana that are known to us. What are these sutras? What are these? The first one is the definition of asana. Sthira sukham asanam. Asana should be stable and comfortable. Stable means it should be dynamically stable. Our body is always in a dynamic state, and regulating the movement in such a way as to achieve stability is the goal of asana. Proper practice of asana would create comfortable feeling. The mechanistic performance of asana without comfortable feeling or evocation of negative feeling is an indicator of improper practice of asana. Now, the second sutra about asana, Prayatna Shaithilya, Ananta Samapatti Bhyam. It tells us how we should do asana. This is to be attained effortlessly by slackening of efforts. See the word that is used by Patanjali. He doesn't say Yatna Shaithilya because some sort of effort is necessary to achieve any posture. But when we achieve it, there should not be excessive efforts for maintaining it. Or even while doing it, there should not be excessive efforts. Asana should happen. It should not be done with lot of efforts. Relaxing asanas will give cool feeling, while muscular ones, if you do, it will create hot feeling. And then the master stroke of Patanjali is the effect of asanas on the body, on us, on the practitioner. He says, Tato dvanva anabhighataha, means the opposites will not affect afterward. Tato means then. If you do the asanas in this manner, the opposites will not affect you. So, what are these opposites? They are on physical and physiological level. They are, what are these opposites? On muscular level, extension and contraction, or inhalation and exhalation, or pure blood, impure blood, their motion is also different. So all these motor nerves, sensory nerves, all these are opposites. And if they are working in a balanced way, then only we are healthy. So on psychological level, the famous one, sukha, dukkha, labhahani, jay, parajaya, nindastuti, all these on the psychological level, and environmental, ushna and shita. So one who practices asanas very, very properly, these opposites will not affect him. Then we come to pranayama. After getting proficiency in asana, Tasmin sati, you use the word tasmin sati means after getting proficiency in asana, breaking the movement of inhalation exhalation is called pranayama. Tasmin sati shvasa prashvasa yor gati vichcheda pranayama. And he gives four varieties of it: bahya, abhyantara, stambhavritti and chaturtha. Beyond that, he doesn't say much about any varieties. The meditative nature of pranayama becomes clear by its effect. It dissolves the covering over inner light, tatakshiyate prakashavaranam, and makes the mind capable of dharana, dharana sucha yogyata manasa. Its practice makes the mind so calm that it can now focus on a particular spot. We come to pratyahara. It is the fifth limb and last limb of Bahiranga Yoga. There are Bahiranga Yoga and Antaranga Yoga also. So it is the last limb, means Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara belong to external yoga. Pratyahara means withdrawing the senses inwards, which happens automatically in yoga because the chitta is internalized due to the practice of asana, pranayama, etc. And then all the senses follow chitta as it were, and they also become internalized. This gives control over ever-wandering senses and prepares the practitioner for internal yogic practices. Now we come to Antaranga Yoga, very important one. It is a succession of three limbs: dharana, dhyana, samadhi, deshabandha, chittasya dharana. Dharana is focusing attention on an internal or external object. Patanjali doesn't say whether it is internal or external, it is your choice. Dhyana is uninterrupted current of cognition, flow of awareness towards the object chosen in dharana. The object should remain the same in dharana also, in dhyana also. And dhyana only will develop in samadhi when only the object shines, means out of dhyata, dhyana and dheya, only dheya remains and other two disappear as it were. And this is samadhi. So dharana, dhyana, samadhi. These three together are called sanyama. And it is the key to attainment. The third chapter of Yoga Sutra, it gives many miraculous powers. And these are mentioned in the third chapter. Many miraculous powers. They are called siddhis in ordinary life, but they are considered as obstacles on the path of yoga. Patanjali gives us this hint that if you want to pursue the path of samadhi, don't go after them. They are the obstacles. This tool of sayama is seen to be applied instinctively by scientists, artists, researchers, other professionals in modern times, not through yoga, but in spite of it also. Next. I want to talk about the discoveries in modern times. Normally, the researches taken up in modern times are by scientists in collaboration. They are excellent examples of technique of sayama. Focusing attention, acute uninterrupted observation, and then absorption in that object. This technique they might have learned in spite of yoga, out of their hard work, out of their tapas. The examples I would like to give are the discovery of existence of subatomic particle Higgs boson or God particle, and the declaration of the detection of gravitational waves from a merger of two black holes at the time of Big Bang. It was declared in 2016, while it was predicted by Einstein in 1916. How are they able to do that? Maybe they have produced finer equipments to observe such phenomena by doing sayama on external things, objects. This highly sophisticated equipment is their extended vision, reaching up to the subtlest of the subtle and biggest of the big. It reaches in the remote past, covering both time and space. After years of observation, contemplation, absorption, there emerged Rutambara Prajna, which gave them insight into cosmic truth. without knowing the yogic process of Sanyama, they have learned it out of their hard work and spontaneously. This may not be preceded by Bahiranga Yoga, as they might be oblivious of Ashtanga Yoga. But such training would help them immensely in balancing all aspects of their personality, namely social, personal, physical, physiological, and emotional. The literary, performing, and visual artists of high caliber, they have the capacity to focus, penetrate, become one with the object, and create wonderful writings or give exquisite performances. They also might not have been trained systematically in yoga, but if they are, then their capacities would be channelized, and then their intuitive insight would flower into pratibha, and it would manifest in ever new forms. We have seen physical benefits, all of you know, but where do we go if we go on the path of yoga? At the advent of Nirvichara Samadhi, Ritambara Prajna, which gives us unerring perception of subtle entities, flashes forth. Then if we go on the path, then unfolds Pratibha, which is inborn, which is not instructed by others, and it gives knowledge without the aid of senses. And then if we go on performing Sanyama on moment and the process of its succession, we get Viveka Jnana. It is Tarakam, Sarva Vishayam, cognizing all objects, Akrama, it doesn't have any sequence, and it transcends the world process, which produces time. I'm just deviating a little because the Yoga Darshana and neuroscience is very useful in understanding yoga. Rapid advancement in neuroscience in the past decade has provided good means to analyze and understand mind-body practices, including yoga. Neuroscience proves that brain never stops changing across the lifespan. This is called neuroplasticity, which is brain's ability to be dynamically responsive to activity and learning. It is the brain's ability to reorganize itself by forming new neural connections throughout our life. Yoga, now see what yoga does? It suppresses all old habits we have seen from Yama up to Dharana Dhyana and initiates new learning. This voluntary activity can change brain maps. Unused areas in the brain can thus be used. Autonomic nervous system, which is active intrinsically, but now it is possible to have control over it through yoga. It is proved by many researchers, and the research is already published in journals. Thus, yoga in its entirety sends stimulus to brain. Because modern science, neuroscience is able to tell us, I'm adding this, the effects on the body come mainly through brain. Yoga finds out the hidden gems in the brain. Thus, the frame of yoga darshana is very wide, which creates varied possibilities from health benefits to wisdom to infinite expanse of knowledge. The yoga tradition took various forms after 10th century AD and developed into Hatha Yoga, Tantra Yoga, Mantra Yoga, Laya Yoga, and so on. Yet Patanjali Yoga Darshan has retained its position as the royal path throughout the ages. Yoga Darshana defines the boundary of what can truly be called yoga, while leaving creative space for the content of actual practices within this framework. So we can call Yoga Darshana as the grammar of yoga. We have seen this, that in asana, in pranayama, in dharana, Patanjali never mentions or never limits our choice. In the recent times, yoga is adapted mainly for health benefits. We have also seen either dilution or in some instances, even total departure from the framework inspired by mundane considerations or reflecting lack of proper insight into basic tenets of yoga. It is advisable to remain within this grand framework of Yoga Darshana to reap its many, many, many infinite benefits. Now, what is the take-home message of Yoga Darshana? Shri Krishna tells Arjuna in Gita, Tasmat Yogi Bhava Arjuna. He did not ask him to be brave because he was already brave. What he lacked was the right attitude, balanced state of mind. So Krishna advises him to acquire that. Patanjali Muni is telling the modern man the same thing. Tasmat Yogi Bhava Manuja. At present, the humanity at large is under the grip of the klesh abhinivesha, fear of death. This fear carries with it insecurity, stress, utter selfishness, hoarding and whatnot. Maharshi Vyas has already told in Mahabharata that happy days have gone, terrible times have come. Each next day is more sinful and the earth has lost her charm. Atikranta sukhaha kalaha. Pratyupasthita darunaha, shvaha shvaha papiya divasaha, prithivi gata yovana. If this is the description of those bygone days, what to say about present? Such dire situations will come and go at their pace. But how do we behave or respond to it? Of course, the response at large is not in the yogic way. In order to acquire it, we have to follow some techniques of pacifying the mind, follow at least one or two each of yamas and niyamas, and give a solid foundation to the practice of asanas and pranayama. We should not stop at this, but continue our journey on this path towards becoming introvert and be in the habit of focusing our mind on anything of our choice. This will slowly but surely balance our mind so that we respond to each and every situation in a proper way. People at large do not have philosophical goals. That is perfectly all right. But each and everybody, irrespective of age, gender, class, religion, can use the techniques given by Patanjali and progress on the path of one's own choice. Svalpam api asya dharmasya prayate mahato bhayat. Dhanyavad.
Ma'am, it was an enlightening lecture, I must say. And I can understand the difficulty you had in trying to crunch all this because it's such a vast subject.
Yeah.
And you have such so many years of experience of both speaking about it as well as practicing it. So I'm sure you would have found it difficult to crunch it in so much time. But I must say, Whatever you shared with us has been great, has been really enlightening. And ma'am, I really liked the importance that you gave. Because asana and pranayama is what is considered today as the crux. But the beauty that you brought about of the yama niyama before that, which establishes the foundation, and the limbs which are after the pranayama.
Yeah.
So this is what the Ashtanga Yoga brings to us. In that aspect, ma'am, I also wanted to ask you, because in the Yoga Darshana, very beautifully, even the yama niyama, Maharshi Patanjali brings out the phala of each of these yama niyama. Right?
Yes. They are also like siddhis. Ayusa pratishthayam tat sannidau vairatyaga and all.
Correct.
So if you follow any of the yama or niyama to the fullest, without exception, you will get all these things.
Absolutely.
Yama, yes. And everybody can follow. You need not do asana pranayama. But in our lives, we can really not say satyam vada dharmam chara. Really, we should imbibe it in our life.
And ma'am, many times I have felt that when we read those phalas, like especially when he speaks about satya. So that means many times when we look at great people, and we attribute that whatever they say, it comes true. Many times we find the Yoga Sutras being the link. On how they are able to do that, or how these are attained by these great Mahatmas. Yeah. I think it's another beautiful link that we have in the Yoga Sutra. Ma'am, there is one question from one of the participants, Krishnan Bharadwaj, where he asks, Klishta, Aklishta, we mentioned about the types of rupees.
Yeah.
And we mentioned about Klesha. Are these two different things or are they the same?
No. When the vrittis are preceded by Kleshas, Klesha hetu kaha. They are called Klishta Vrittis. So any Vritti means Pratyaksha Pramana. Suppose I am watching something. And I feel I have gone to somebody's place. Okay, that house is beautiful, beautifully decorated, and I feel, oh, my house is not so good, ahankara. So I will start having jealousy of outer, dvesha. I'll feel insecure to call that person to my house because my house is not that good, abhinivesha. All our activities normally are prompted by these. But many times we have aklishta vrittis also. Not all the time we are like that, you know.
Right.
Many times they are aklishta. But many times, and I should say, sorry, few times they are aklishta. Many aklishta. Yeah. If you just analyze your behavior, one or more out of these are there. Klesha.
Right. And then there's another question related to this itself, because you mentioned when you spoke about the pancha kleshas,
yeah,
and you started with avidya, and you said that avidya, yeah, is the moola.
Yeah.
So one of the participants, Geetinder, she wanted to know, what is the source of this avidya?
Avidya is beginningless, they say. You are born with it. It's beginningless.
Right.
And when avidya goes, everything goes. And Ramana Maharshi's life is the example of this. When right. he understood that I am not this dead body, because he had that experience. He felt that he's going to die, isn't it?
Right.
He was caught by that. He was under the grip of abhinivesha, that I will die.
Right.
He created a corpse. And he said, even if this body is dead, I am not dead. Hear this I from within.
Correct.
When that went away, you know?
Yeah.
Nitya, nitya and all those non-self, self.
Yes.
Not this body. And avidya went away, everything went away.
Right.
Raga, dvesha, abhinivesha, all went away.
And ma'am, this anadi avidya can be very much taken to be also the source that we consider in Advaita, right?
Yeah.
We consider a very similar
Maya.
Beginning
yeah.
point of Maya yeah. In Advaita. Ma'am, the other question that has come from one of the participants is, you mentioned about the limbic region where the
yeah.
different,
yeah.
You know, the kleshas
regions.
Are
associated. Yeah, yeah.
They wanted to know, is this some recent research that has happened in this area? And this is
yeah,
that?
Yeah. Yes. Lot of research has occurred, and it is mostly done abroad. And some research is done in Nimhans also, Bangalore. And the results are out because I have done a course with them.
Right.
So many of the articles I have read them, and we are taught all these things.
Okay.
The doctors.
Okay. Ma'am, the other question that has come is from another participant, Narasimhan. He's asked, could you suggest some practices for quietening the mind?
Yeah. Chitta Prasadana, what Patanjali says only I will say. So he says, Omkara Japa. Not just om, 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 but pondering over its meaning. Or Prachardana Vidharana Abhyamva Pranasya. Doing pranayam. Here he is going that exhaling and then retaining, but retention after exhalation is very difficult. But if you do inhale slowly and exhale, you know, through mouth, it becomes very long, and that also calms down the mind.
Mm.
Or you can meditate on some point within, that also is possible at your heart or somewhere in between the eyebrows. Or sometimes, you know, vitaraga vishayam va chittam. So many people, they are devoted to saints. All over India, we have so many saints. When you go to their math or go to their ashram, you feel very, very calm and quiet. So if you feel calm and quiet like that, or do the sadhana given by them initially, japa, namasparana, whatever, all that also will make you calm. Or Sri Karuna Mudita Upeksha. So many he has given. So we cannot try all. We
right.
should choose one which suits us, one or two, and should start.
Okay. Great,
ma'am. Ek one minute. Mitarka Badane Pratipaksha Bhavana.
Yes.
Why do we behave in contrary way? Why do we do Yusa? Why is this Vitarka? At that time, if the thought of Himsa, hurting somebody, comes to your mind, ponder. Ponder all the time with all your energy on the opposite. What is the opposite of Yusa? Ahimsa. And many students of mine have told me that this is a very powerful technique. Pratipaksha Bhavana is a very, very powerful technique. Many students have given me the feedback.
And ma'am, what you're saying is very critical, because thinking before what you are, you know, acting upon.
Yeah.
So what you're saying is that when a thought comes also, you just give some time to the thought.
Yeah. Immediately don't give a reaction.
Yes, you respond, yeah.
Reaction, we should right. respond. And respond, it takes some time.
Right.
Reaction is immediate. It's a reflex.
Correct. Absolutely. I think this will be a great tool for people, not to react but to respond. How do you
No, formerly they used to say count 10 numbers.
Yeah.
If you count 4-5 numbers also, it's okay. Or bring your awareness to your breath. Pranadharana. Immediately, you know, you will not respond.
Right.
You will react, I'm sorry, you will respond.
Correct.
Many methods are there. All based on Patanjali Yoga Sutra.
Yeah, absolutely. Ma'am, I think the beauty is what you, and very nicely you mentioned those four ways and other things, right? Because even though Patanjali mentioned so many things, many of these things are all different alternates and options given to you.
Yeah.
Because as you rightly said, it's impossible for one person to sit and do everything, because this is about one of the questions that has come. Yeah. You know, should we do this one by one? You know, one after the other, keep on doing this. But I think for the essence of what
I explained, It's not sequential.
Yeah.
Throughout life.
Yeah.
Asana, as long as you get proficiency in sitting in one asana, meditative asana for 2.5 hours. Asana jaya, that is what is said in tradition. But say 30 minutes, that is also fine.
Yeah.
Pranayama. Slowly you go to pratyahara. Up to dharanana, any yoga teacher can lead you. Then you practice on your own, and then you can go progress further.
And ma'am, also the important part here is, and because you mentioned about the sequentiality, even when you are progressing, it's very important for you to be rooted in the Yama Niyama, because if you leave that, you can slip anytime.
Correct. And see, each Yama Niyama, no? Why we behave improperly again due to collisions.
Yeah.
Each and every time we have to just have this balance.
Correct. Then there is another question from one of our participants, Devananda. He says that in the West, what they do currently, the focus primarily of yoga, primarily on the physical aspect, is it defeating the very purpose of yoga?
Yes.
Just focusing.
Yes. Because if we take Patanjali Yoga Darsana as the basic text,
right?
As I told you, you might forget all its Sankhya metaphysics, Drushehe Kaivalyam, Tadadrashtu Swarupe Avasthanam. Forget it. Everybody may not have this goal. There are not very few people will have this goal.
Right.
But how I said, we want to live this life. And how? Nowadays, I have not taken the name of this whatever we are suffering now, but I have explained it to you.
Correct.
Just performing asanas in that way will not give you this yogic balanced state of mind.
Right.
Whenever I go to any class and ask what is the meaning of yoga, and I'm teaching them Patanjali Yoga Sutra, I'm not just teaching them yoga. I do accept that yoga has this meaning also.
Right.
Word yoga. I'm saying the word yoga.
Right.
We find both the meanings. But when I'm teaching Patanjali Yoga Sutra, and when I'm asking what is the meaning of yoga in Patanjali Yoga Sutra, at that time also, if you say it is joining, it is so wrong, because then you have to take into consideration the metaphysics.
Yes.
It is balanced state of mind. I think it is good, you know, this only meaning of yoga is good.
Absolutely, ma'am. Because I think the kind of holistic definition with Maharshi Patanjali gives, by just limiting it to some asana or pranayama, we are actually restricting the whole concept. Yeah.
Yes.
Ma'am, another question that is...
Okay.
Sorry, ma'am. Please go ahead.
No. What I'm saying that it doesn't say also in dharana, whether you should do dharana in internal or external. That is why I gave you the example of modern researchers. Isn't it sayama?
Yeah.
They are not on their own. But sometimes, no, their health is not good. They are not good human beings. Many of them, we hear about them. It's hearsay. Maybe it's hearsay. But if you do not strive to be a good human being, you will not be a good human being. Because all this is given in your head in order to survive. And that we are implementing in a wrong way.
Beautiful, beautiful, ma'am. And the other question that has come is Asmita.
Yes.
When he spoke about Asmita, how different it is from empathy?
Empathy is very, very different. You understand what the other person is suffering from, thinking of, and Asmita is identifying. You are my daughter. How can you think in that way? Asmita will be like that. But if I have empathy, I will go into her, I will be of her age and think, okay, the modern girls are thinking like that. Or if my granddaughter asks me something, she might be only 10 years of age.
Yeah.
So that is empathy. How can you behave like that when your grandma is like this? This is Asmita.
Ma'am, so I think Asmita still, the focus is on yourself. The individual is the focus.
I, me, mine.
But
this belongs to me. Somebody else. Empathy.
Great, ma'am.
Completely different.
Absolutely. Ma'am, you spoke about Samadhi.
Yeah.
So there is also one question of Jui among the participants. So when we spoke about Samadhi, you spoke about the Dharana, Dhyana and Samadhi.
Samadhi,
right?
Yeah.
So when we have the, there also you have the Savikalpaka, Nirvikalpaka Samadhi, correct?
We say Sabija Nirbija in Patanjali Yoga.
The Sabija Nirbija.
Or Sampradnyata Anyam. Or Sampradnyata.
So reaching the Nirbija Samadhi is ultimate objective of the Yoga Sutra, correct?
Yes.
Of the Yoga Darshana.
Yes.
And for them, liberation means reaching the Nirbija Samadhi.
Tadadrashtu Swarupe Avasthanam. That is Nirbija.
Understood. Ma'am, somebody's asked this question. I don't know. It's a bit tricky, but is it possible if a person is in Samadhi, would he be open to the external world? Like talking, doing normal activities. Does a person remaining in Samadhi perform activities in the world?
It is because we understand the wrong meaning of Samadhi. We feel that you sit in some meditative posture, close your eyes, shut everything. That is not Samadhi. Let me just tell you one thing.
Yeah.
Like Mahasha, you know.
Yeah.
He was a great Grihastha yogi. Somebody asked him, what do you do when you are in Samadhi? He says, I get up from the bed, I take a bath, I go to Ganga. While coming, I buy vegetables. I help my wife in doing that. All this is going on in Samadhi. I think it will explain.
Beautiful. Beautifully explained, ma'am. Beautiful.
That is Samadhi, you know. Balanced state of mind, whatever you might be doing.
Right.
So first, we should remove from our mind this meaning that Samadhi means shutting your eyes and for 1 hour, 2 hours. Nobody, we should expect others not to disturb our peace. And in third, we are most unpeaceful. No peace from within at all. Lot of chattering is going on.
Absolutely, that, absolutely, ma'am.
That is not Samadhi.
Absolutely. Ma'am, there is one question that has come of Arjun Narayanan, who says that today we speak about the pranic healing through chakras, etc. Is this anywhere an offshoot of the Kriya Yoga of the Yoga Sutras, or is it a completely different?
Completely different. Okay. It is Svadhyaya Ishvara Prandhana, Kriya Yoga. He doesn't mention any Kundalini and all. That doesn't mean Patanjali didn't know about it. It's not mentioned. His path is different. That path is different.
And also, ma'am, the asanas and other things, I think it's because of Hatha Yoga and the later offshoots of...
Because of Hatha Yoga.
Right.
And these were popularized because it is easy to popularize physical things.
Yeah.
And many a times, only asanas are taught, not even pranayam in a proper way. They are taught in as a deep breathing way. It is not pranayam.
Right. Great, ma'am. I think there are many, 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 many questions. Probably we'll take all these questions and maybe we'll reach out to you later properly so that you can then help us out with the responses. But ma'am, I must say that the last 60, 70 minutes that we have spent on this, it's been great. It's been extremely enlightening for us. And clearing, I think, true to the topic, what it is and what it is not. I think, ma'am, you have very clearly mentioned this out, and I hope all the listeners and the participants have really benefited through this discussion and your message, ma'am. Thanks a lot for this. Dr. Mahulika, ma'am.
Thank you, Veena, for a wonderful exposition. And this is not just a theory, this is practice. And what you said, you know, heyam dukkham anagatam, and you have given us the key to remove this dukkha in the way of the take-home things, you know, like pratipaksha bhavana, especially on abhinivesha, which is very, very essential in this era. So I think this is a wonderful, wonderful lecture with lot of relevance. And I may tell all the participants that Dr. Veena Lunde had presented a symposium on yoga and neuroscience in the Indian Science Congress, 102nd Indian Science Congress, hosted by Mumbai University in January 2015. And it was very well received. And there, you know, she had presented her research along with her doctor's team. So it's not only a Sanskritist talking something on the basis of theoretical knowledge, but it was experimented fully, and the output was, you know, shared with the participants. So thank you, Veena, so much for accepting our invitation and being here with us today. And it's a lot of preparation from your side to make it easy and understandable for people like us, you know. So thank you so much from Chinmaya Vishwavidyapeeth. I thank you, and I look forward to your continued association with CVV. And over to Subbu for closing of this session. Thank you, Subbu.
So participants, I think what we must take also from this session, and this session was quite important from that perspective, is that please treat yoga and start studying yoga as a darshana, as a more holistic way of life, rather than just focusing on the asanas or the pranayama. There is much, much more to yoga as a way of life. So this is one key message that we must take. And we, who are the participants of this session, must act as votaries for this, for the external world as well. We now end with the Shanti Mantra. भद्रं कर्णेभ्यः शृणुयाम देवाः भद्रं पश्येमाक्षभिर्यजत्राः स्थिरैरङ्गैः स्तुष्टुवागुंसस्तनूभिः व्यशेम देवहितैर्यदायुः स्वस्ति न इन्द्रो वृद्धश्रवाः स्वस्ति नः पूषा विश्ववेदाः स्वस्ति नस्तार्क्ष्यो अरिष्टनेमिः स्वस्ति नो बृहस्पतिर्दधातु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः